So, I wasn't sure if it was going to be too boring for everybody, so I just get a bunch of some quotations, so maybe there can be at least something worthy for you and something that could be even more interesting than my presentation. So, first I mentioned somebody that was by technical reports and was in touch with them, it's Perez-Diaz. And well, that's about many other strange chances of the world ahead of shall come from the hands of the weak, of the wise part. That's something that you will see that it's something to do with this presentation. Well, the Counterfog is a project that is funded by the European Commission in the 7th Framework Program, and in which there are 10 institutions involved. United Kingdom, Germany, Czech Republic, Bulgaria, and Spain, and Sweden. And the objective of this project is to provide a rapid response for collapsing all kinds of dispersed agents. And all kinds means a general purpose system. It could be for chemical, biological, nuclear, or even smoke, or any kind of things. It should be incorporated into a fire protection system. It may also be used for open conditions, and for sure it should be fast and to provide an early response. That's up. That were our objectives when we started this project. You know that most of the incidents that we can find are related to very similar situations. I mean, you will have cloud, a sort of dispersion of particles, a sort of dispersion of spores, a sort of dispersion of bacteria, or maybe it's chemicals that are in the gaseous form. And it could be, for sure, both caused by terrorist attacks or whatever, but also it's a case that it could be caused by accidents, if you need to have really in mind, because the freight of hazardous freight is quite a concern. If we consider what's really the risk of many of the agents that we are dealing with, they rely on the fact that they are in dispersed form. An example is anthrax, that it's a classical disease of circulars. And for them, it's just something that creates a problem on their skins. Let's say that's all. But when you have a dispersed group of spores and you breathe them, you will have a very serious problem. So, let's consider what's the size of what we are dealing with. Well, just to keep in mind, this would be a sort of human hair. That's the size of it. And this would be the size of fine sand, or beach sand we are used to play with. And the most dangerous particles that we usually breathe in air are those that are even smaller. The problem with these particles below 10 microns and even below 2.5 microns is that we breathe them, they penetrate our lungs, and even if they are smaller than 2.5, they can even penetrate the blood and all tissues. So the real danger is that they move in a way that we cannot control. Usually, we think that, well, we know that atmosphere has natural mechanisms to wash out air. Unfortunately, all these particles are really falling down, and also they act as condensing nuclei for humidity, and so they droplet condenser around them, and they fall down, and so they are naturally removed. But these mechanisms are too slow for our problems. So we study what happens with this kind of problems. So we have to start from scratch, take some mathematics tools, and study what's the dynamics of these particles. And forget about air, as you know now. I invite you to imagine that you are quite small small as 10 microns. If you were 10 microns, air would be no longer as such that you feel it now. You would be like in a jungle jelly. You couldn't move anything because the effect of viscosity of air prevails over any other effect. So imagine you are not feeling gravity, but you are feeling the jelly you have around you. That would be our world at that scale. So now that we are at that scale, take account of equations of Navier-Stokes and all the mathematics that is around the flow of viscous fluids, and then we will get to some conclusions. Is that, for instance, if we can calculate the flow, the force that the flow around a particle generates, and it's quite simple because it's proportional to the radius of the particle, and then we can find also what's the terminal speed of a particle if we let it there. So there is an important fact here. A particle with density of water of 2 microns will have a velocity of 0.7 centimeters per minute. Meanwhile, a 10 micron particle will have 18. So it's important to keep in mind that very small particles are really dragged by air. They don't fall down. But 10 microns particles, they still have a relatively short time to fall down. So if we put 10 micron liquid droplet and let it in air from 2.4 meters, that is on top of a ceiling, it will take 14 minutes to fall down. Okay, so if we take one of these droplets and try to eject it into an air, that would be what a terrorist would try to do if he wants to spread spores. The point is that, fortunately, they have a very short time to get adapted to the speed of the air which you are impeding them. So the point is that if I have a flow and I put these small droplets, spores, or whatever, they will follow the air. That's quite important to have in mind. And we can calculate the space it will go. So we design something to track these particles. And taking the idea of Tolkien, we will take advantage of the wick. So we will go to droplets, small droplets, water droplets, or maybe another liquid droplets. We can put some, for instance, hydrogen peroxide or any kind of disinfectant we can use. And would provide, again, a liquid that is important. And if they fall down and they find these small particles that are the risky ones, they will catch them, increase them in their volume, and fall down. And just by natural falling down, we will be catching them. That's a nice idea. But you will say, okay, this is something that is what we try to do. We spray water or our splinters in fire protection system. There's no key. Okay, but there is a small problem with this. The small problem is that sometimes this is not what it happens. I mean, if the droplets you are using are too big and the particles you are trying to catch up are too small, the point is that, remember, they live in a jelly. So they follow the flow of air. And the point is that they will be just flowing around the big particle, and you will never catch it. And that's the problem if you sprinkle water just with conventional systems. droplets are too big to catch up spores, bacteria, and whatever. This is a simple physical principle, but that's essential to know that. And that's just to be conscious of the jelly nature of air at this scale. So now, what can we do? It's quite simple. We have to catch up particles under 10 microns, so we can use droplets from, let's say, 2 to 20 microns. It's quite simple. It's cheap. It's natural. It's green. You're using not anything toxic or anything that could be corrosive or anything like that. It's just physics. Additionally, if you want to remove gases from the air, well, most of chemical agents can be hydrolyzed. And that's very good, because we can use these droplets also to hydrolyze these gases. The point is that if you calculate the surface and time that this exposes this surface to the air, the product is independent of the size of the droplets. So if you put a number of droplets of this size in air, you will obtain the same result as if you put the same number of droplets much bigger or much smaller. The point is, much smaller than 2 microns will never fall down. And much bigger, maybe you will have a huge amount of waste that will be a problem itself. So again, it's an optimized solution to have this good size. So we tested it. We built a laboratory that is available now in the CIMAT facilities in Madrid. And well, this laboratory was providing a system to work with surrogates, with simulants, not the real agents. We are in the center of Madrid, and it would be a bit risky to do that. But even though we can use it for these surrogates, and we took a lot of preventive actions, like providing with absolute filters, having two rooms as a or recovering all the waste that is generated. In that laboratory, we have performed tests related with particles, with spores and smoke, and many aspects of the photodynamics. And we use this equipment for measuring the number of particles, for measuring the active biological elements that are floating in the air. For sure, we measure temperature, humidity, and many other things. And now I will invite you to visit our laboratory and to observe how the counterfog works. This is our counterfog acting in the laboratory. And as you will see, fortunately, you see just at the visible light, and that's the size of our droplets. So as the wavelength of visible light is more or less that of our droplets, if there is a fog, you will see nothing because you see the fog. So you see that it's a 30-second shoot that fills the full room, and it's enough to start the washout procedure. That's the aspect of our laboratory when it's completely full of fog.
And that is with water.
In this case, it's just water. Tap water, you know. It's So this is the distribution. Well, the design of this nozzle has been an engineering, a nice piece of engineering work. Has been using simulation and multidisciplinary approach, and we get this nice result. That is, this is the experimental distribution of droplets in our room for a typical application. As you will see, this is the 2.5 micron size, the 5 micron size, and 10 micron size. So this is the ideal distribution for washing out the size of particles we have. Sorry. We tested what's the dynamic of them. If we just put this water droplets we will obtain this kind of, it was exposed in the poster, and you see that this is the natural fold down dynamics that you expect for this kind of description we have done. So we are testing our theoretical formula. These are the results with the radioactive and nuclear surrogates. We use a list of them from urea, sodium chloride, talcum. Essentially, we took them as surrogates of annular radioactive sounds, and the point is we tested how they evolve naturally. These are the natural evolution of them, just if you spread them. And this is the effect of the counterfog accident. This is the number of particles you have when you spread, and we are showing only the 5 micron and 10 microns. And you will see we have with the counterfog. At that point, the detector of particles counts both particles and water droplets. So that's why they increase. And as the number of droplets is falling down, you see that the final number of droplets, of particles, sorry, have also fallen down. So we are removing 2 to 3 orders of magnitude of particles. Consider that this is a logarithmic scale. Well, we repeated it for different compounds. For most of them, the results are quite similar. But when you come to the talcum, that is hydrophobic, you have a problem because it doesn't disappear. It's impressive because you spread your talcum powder. This is the kind that we usually use for domestic uses. Okay, and you spread it, you shoot all the fog you have seen, and after the fog drops down, the talcum is still there. So particles and water have repelled themselves. So they are on track. But fortunately, there is a way to solve that. It's to add an additive just to reduce the surface tension of water. And when we get to just 1% of an additive, which is quite simple, that it's absolutely harmless, we achieve, again, a good result. And we test it again with chemical surrogates. I think this was shown in a previous presentation, so I will not go into further details. But also the results for methyl succinate and the protein we call the diethyl or diethyl phosphate were quite successful. In this case, using also particles, nanostructural particles of titanium oxide. In this case, the point is that water is useful not only to remove the chemicals, but also these particles that were useful for removing the chemicals. And this is part of another poster that was shown the day before yesterday. Also, tests with biological surrogates were carried out. We used Bacillus thuringiensis as a surrogate of Bacillus. And let's say that after contamination of the laboratory, we applied our counterfog. And we tested it for different durations, 15, 30, and 1 minute. And the result is after, let's say, with 1 minute actuation of the counterfog, as you see, the system is completely clean. Let's say we have, in 15 seconds of actuation, we got 91% of efficiency, with 30 seconds, 98, and for this measurement, it was 100%. For sure, we have to test it with many other systems. Additionally, we tested the toxicity of itself of the counterfog, because that's something just in case we are applying. Nobody expects that the water fog could be harmful, but who knows? So we have tested some tests with mice. And long-term experiments that are currently going on, They are running up to a couple of months still in front of us. So we will see if there is any kind of damage in the long term. The position for this mice was even longer than it was needed for moving back. So I'm finishing. So the idea and the future in front of us is that this kind of system could be easily deployed in large facilities or in facilities where a lot of people is involved, or critical infrastructures and so on. In this way, there will be a sort of a set of nozzles provided with something as simple as water or a solution with that and compressor line, quite simple. And what is important is that, on the contrary of other fire protection systems that use fog, the pressure that we need for the air compressor system is very low. So we don't need special bottles or high pressure system or whatever. We are able to provide a fog, a very dense fog, with very low pressures. That's quite convenient and safe. It could be also deployed in a sort of open field. Open field tests will be done in the very few months. This project will end in October this year. And the system has been assembled on board on a truck. And also we are taking precautions. Additionally, we have patented the technology. That's quite important because that's our duty according to the agreement signed with the European Commission. Even if there are some restrictions for the use of this technology and the export licenses and so on, I think they will clarify in the very few months, because there is an essential property of this technology, is that it cannot be used properly as a misuse or dual use, because essentially it falls down in a few minutes. So it's something essentially for defense and not for attack, was the concern. So as a conclusion, we demonstrated that the system fulfills our objectives. We are still working on that, and it has been demonstrated with these surrogates. And well, I didn't mention, but we also demonstrated that it's able to wash out the diesel smoke we provide in cities. And finally, let's say that another quote for those that would be bored at this time. Somebody that I visited 2 days ago that said that scientists, precisely because they know more, are called to serve more, since the freedom they join in research gives them access to specialized knowledge. They have the responsibility of using that knowledge wisely for the benefit of the entire human family. That's from John Paul II. And I think that we have enjoyed studying this subject, and we have the fortune of having found something that I think is good for all humanity. Well, thank you very much.